example, one time, this is a college story, if you don't mind, a little brief reference to college life. There was a guy in the next room in the old dorm, and he was struggling his way. He had the brief illusion that he was a born chemist. That was a brief illusion. Well into the second semester, he discovered he was not only not a chemist, he was really, the only thing that he had a talent for was failure. He was about to fail his final exam in chemistry. He studied for 7 straight nights, all night long. He had all kinds of guys in there helping him. And the day that the exam occurred, I remember it well, the day dawned, well, that usual kind of grim, cold spring day with the wind blowing out of the north and a driving sleety rain, and budding failure struggled off into the wind carrying his pencils, about to take a blue book exam that would determine his entire fate for the next 4 years at least, if not his entire life. It was a 3-hour exam, and I happened to have the morning off, so I'm sitting around in the dormitory looking out of the window and thinking about girls, which is about all we ever did in the dormitory. Various things you think about girls, how to trap them, how to get rid of the ones you've already trapped and who are now trapping you. it's a long, complex thing. You've gone through this, of course, are they? And so I'm sitting there, my jaw hanging slack, eating what at that time was a major obsession with me. For some strange reason, in my second year in school, in college, I got on an absolutely uncontrollable Fig Newton kick. The Fig Newton had gotten me, the mystique of the Fig Newton. I had graduated from the Twinkie stage, which was a brief period in my teens and early adolescent period. I went through a brief period when I found, for some strange reason, I found there was a cheese spread called Pabstat. Did you ever hear of a cheese? You know, these cheese spreads that kind of an American cheese. I went through a period where I couldn't get enough of that stuff. And then I suddenly sickened of that, even after I tried the pimento cheese spread, which held me only briefly. And then I went into the Fig Newton phase. And I was really seriously in the Fig Newton phase. I even began to become aficionado of the Fig Newton, much as, say, the late Clifton Webb in the movies was always an aficionado of fine wines. You remember Clifton Webb? Charles Boyer is always hit me as in the movies as being the final authority on things like wine and women. Do you remember the commercials he made a few years ago that were all over the radio? Love is a ball. You remember that? Love is a ball. This is Charles Boyer. Charles Boyer. But nevertheless, you'll notice my imitation is not much better than any of your average Catskill Comics imitation. Although if he showed up doing that on the Johnny Carson show, you would believe it's good. But because I do it here, you say, listen to this fool, this slob, this knave. But I'm deeply involved in the Fig Newton. And I did not know until that period that there are many forms of Fig Newton. Did you know that you can get an apricot Fig Newton? Sounds like a contradiction in terms, but you can. Are you aware that there is also a raspberry Fig Newton? It's just quite good if you can get the teeth out of your, you know, the seeds out of your teeth after a bout with the raspberry Fig Newton. Another one that's very good, in case you've never tried it, is the strawberry Fig Newton. Although it's a little sweet for my taste, since, like most aficionados, I began to drift further and further away from the obvious and the popular. When a person drinks wine for the first time, he believes wine should be sweet. You can always tell a rookie wine drinker because he likes stuff that pours out of the bottle like pancake syrup, and he loves that. You know, the kind of stuff that makes your teeth whistle Dixie as soon as you start drinking it. You know, that's known as the Manischewitz syndrome. A sense of irony is only produced by repeated failures. One does not develop a sense of irony when one is, say, Mickey Mantle. No way. You do, however, develop a sense of irony if you are, say, for example, Bud Harrelson, or even the Who is the famous guy that that used to wear the glasses? Come on, let's see. Phil Lenz, of course. He was, yes. No, he never did play the accordion, nor did he play the harmonica. This was, again, one of those myths foisted off on us by Maury Allen of the Post. It drives ballplayers right up the wall. But that, nevertheless, right, you develop a sense of irony through failure. And I'm sitting in there eating the waiter with the Fig Newtons, and I was making an experiment. There was a brief flurry out in the area where I went to school, which happened to be Indiana, the University of. And I was sitting out there. At that time, there was a brief flurry of excitement over what they call the butterscotch iced Fig Newton. Well, I admit I was sucked in. And I had gotten a 2-pound box of butterscotch iced Fig Newtons, but at the time, there's a certain period in your life where you don't throw anything away. You doggedly go at it. And I was doggedly working my way through a 2-pound box of butterscotch iced Fig Newtons. They were terrible. But anyway, you know, it was a commitment, and I was going at it. So I'm sitting there gnawing away at the Fig Newtons, and it was about a quarter after 11, quarter to 12, something like that, when I hear the dragging footsteps of somebody going past my door. You could hear the feet dragging. And I look up, and I hear the door next to me slam. Slam. Boom. At that point, I says, I see Howard's home. He's back home. I wonder how it went. It was immediately answered for me. I heard a thud, a crash, the sound of a chemistry book being hurled from one end of this small room to the other. The door opens again, and I hear the shower clogs. Shower clogs play a great role in the dormitory life. If you've ever lived in the dormitory life, you realize that there are many emergencies over shower clogs. One of the most emergencies, first of all, the emergencies sometimes are caused by dire epidemics. For example, we had one character who, incidentally, everybody got so bugged at him because he wouldn't wear shower clogs in the shower, and everybody in the entire dormitory got a fantastic case of athlete's foot, which we traced immediately down to Clarence because he was a walking case of everything. This guy, if you can get it, he got it. He got it every conceivable way. And, there was a period when people wouldn't even let him, you know, you go to the John. They wouldn't let him go to the John until they made him go out in the bushes because everybody's afraid of what they're going to catch from him. But this kind of, incidentally, he is now the president of a large insurance company. And every time I see this guy, you know, occasionally he pops up in the news. I think about if they only knew what Clarence was like back in the days. I can't tell you what Clarence was called. You know what he... All right, I'll tell you what he was called, if you know what the story of life is. I presume that you do know a few things. He was called... His nickname was a four-letter word that has to do with a social disease. It begins with a C. That's all they called him. You know, like some guys are called Sam, other guys are called Fred, and other guys are called Aki. He was simply called by that simple four-letter word. And they would say, uh-oh, here comes. And everybody sort of shrink back into their rooms because they were afraid if you get too close to them, you might catch something that is airborne. there was a period when there was such a big battle over him one time about the shower clogs because everyone knew where the athlete's foot was coming from, and he had a curious type of athlete's foot. It was some kind of a rare oriental athlete's foot that attacked the marrow of your bones. It was unbelievable. So he would not wear his shower clogs, at which point there was a suggestion that we take him down. There was a stable that wasn't too far from the university, you know, where the elegant students would go and ride, and that there was a veterinarian who appeared there occasionally. We were thinking of taking him down and literally having shower clogs nailed on his feet by the vet, have him shod. At which point, so you know, these are the kind of dramatic moments you have in dormitory life. It is not all beer and skittles, nor is it all intellectual pursuits, as you know, Jerry. There's other things happen in these dormitory hassles, and I'm sitting in there eating my butterscotch iced Fig Newtons, and I hear Howard shower clogs drag past the door, and he's on his way down to the shower. Well, I still didn't know exactly how he did. And I heard the water come on in the shower. You know, had this water. It took maybe 20, 30, 40 minutes for it to get tepid in our dormitory. And it started out throwing. It was amazing. I never saw a shower like that one, as a matter of fact. In the middle of summer, the hottest days, you're going to summer school there, temperature's like 115 outside. You go down to get a drink out of the water faucet. The water comes out boiling. You could make tea right out of the water that came out of the faucet. The shower? No way. You turn that shower on, ice cubes come out. I mean, it's fantastic. You know, all kinds of icicles would come right out of the shower in the middle of the hottest weather. So, conversely, when you wanted warm water, it would take maybe 15, 20 minutes, a half an hour for it to get tepid. And so I hear the water running in there, and there's dead silence except for the water. And I'm all by myself on the upper floor of the dorm, me and Howard. And it was then that I learned that there are people who do have a sense of irony. I hear the shower going, and I hear the Howard's shower clogs go clop, 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 clop. And then I heard the shower turn on a little bit higher, and Howard's voice rolled out pure and clean with the echo that always comes when people sing in a shower. And I could hear him singing, "Oh, sweet mystery of life, unending ever." I knew then that he had failed. No question. No question at all, Howard had booted another one, and another career had gone down the drain. Now, I'm not going to explain that to you. Those of you who know what the implications are when a guy goes into the shower and sings, "Oh, sweet mystery of life, unending ever." This was a remarkably profound statement. The kind of statement that deserves to be made more often. Will never be made by people like Jimmy Breslin, for example, who do not think there's any mystery of life. They're just a lot of slobs and him. And if they obeyed what he says they ought to do, everything would work out great. Oh, no. The Howards of this world know better. Especially since his father was a leading research chemist with Standard Oil of Indiana. It was going to be very difficult to explain what happened that afternoon or that morning, that three-hour desperate morning, and his shower clogs went dragging back. You could hear him just scraping away, and he goes into the room there, slams the door, and my friend, who at Jack Miner, as a matter of fact, was my roommate, Jack comes strolling in. I had a roommate that looked like Yogi Bear, you know, the kind of dumb-looking, dumb, fat and happy. You remember Yogi Bear? You say, "I'm smarter than the average ranger." You remember him when he's always doing that? Well, Jack Miner used to come in and say, "I can't imagine what's the matter with me? I'm better looking than everybody else." He never made it with anything. He never could understand why. And Jack Miner comes walking in dumb, fat, and happy, 375 pounds. You know, the kind of guy who takes up smoking a pipe in the first year of college, and he smokes this obscene pipe tobacco. I mean, there's a kind of pipe tobacco, when you open the can, you have visions of houses of ill fame on the Turkish coast on Saturday night. Oh, my God, what a smell. And when he would stuff it in his pipe and light the pipe, great clouds of this bluish-black smoke would come out. And it would hang. This stuff, you couldn't get rid of it. It was like a fungus. It would hang in the room. I would walk in the room some days, and my head would be in this cloud. It would just hang, like, you know, like a low-laying cloud layer in the room for weeks on end. And it would be from about the ceiling down to, I'd say about shoulder level. And so your head would be up in there. And for that reason, I insisted on the lower bunk. And Miner would live in the top bunk amid this gray purple cloud that had flowers growing out of it. This stuff was so pungent, Art, that when the smoke would get, you know, the smoke ferments a little after it's been up there for a long enough time, that you could see ants eating it and stuff. We used to have trouble with cockroaches come in and eat the smoke. I mean, it was that kind of stuff. So Jack walks in, big as life. He comes wandering in. He says, "Hi." He's always known for his cutting wit and his magnificent ad libs. "Hi." I'd say, "Hi, Jack. How about a fig Newton?" That was a rhetorical question, because Jack would always grab whatever you were eating without question or asking. And we used to carry on a kind of a charade of civility. I'd say, "How about a fig Newton, Jack?" You know, before he grabbed it right out of my mouth, big fat old Jack. So I said, "How about a fig Newton, Jack?" I was anxious to get rid of these anyway. Jack didn't eat like most people did. He mulched. If you know much about the larger ruminants, you know what is it, a ruminant? A ruminant is not a bum that walks around down in the Bowery. A ruminant is a cud-chewing animal. Now, Jack chewed a cud. He never chewed gum or anything. He was always chewing on a cud. Well, it was a cud. It was a strange thing he was chewing. And so Jack would start mulching among the fig Newtons. And then there was another thump next door, and he said, "What's that?" I said, "It's Howard." And Jack, of course, never wanted to leave well enough alone. He said, what's bugging him? I said, "Why don't you go ask him, Jack? I'm not going to bother him." He said, "Oh, okay." Now, he only went next door to see if Jack had any salami, or if Howard had salami. Howard was a salami cuckoo, and Howard always had salami in his room. Jack gets up, and he loved to mix salami with fig Newtons. Jack had a lot of that's the ruminant for you. So he gets up and walks out into the hall and bangs on the door, and at which point Howard, you hear the voice of Howard, he had this voice that came like it was out of an Egyptian tomb, you know. "What do you want?" Jack Hollis, "You got any salami?" And there was a pregnant pause, and the door opens, and I hear a couple of muffled voices, and Jack goes in to the room. And about 10 seconds later, he comes out, and he's got about a foot and a half long salami with him, just with the end cut off. He's got it, see? He comes out, and I said, how come Howard gave you all the salami? He gave you the whole salami. At which point, Jack says, "Well, I don't know. He's packing. He's packing in there. He's packing his stuff in a bag." I said, "And you went in there and took his salami?" He says, "Well, give it to me." He says he wasn't going to need no salami. He's going home. I said, "Do you know what's happened to Howard today?" And Jack said, "What do you mean?" I said, "He has just failed an organic chemistry exam. And it's a historic failure. This is the final exam. He is not going to come back." At which point, Jack, this is the cruelty of the college student. At which point, Jack says, "Oh, really?" I said, "Yeah." He says, "Hey, I wonder if he'd give me his desk lamp." At which point, he goes back into the room. You know, I'm just going to say that if you believe that there is sensitivity among youth, I have known too many. At which point, Jack goes in, big 375-pound Jack, with his pipe going full blast, sending sparks into the air and purple smoke into the closet. He walks out into Howie's room again. And this is one of the very few moments in my life that I have seen justice meted out where it was deserved. I hear a little muttering in there, and all of a sudden, a lot of scuffling, and with that, I hear a kind of a thumping and a squeak, and then a desk lamp has come sailing out of Howie's room and has caught Jack on the back of the neck, ricocheted, and bounced off the ceiling and crashed into 4,000 pieces all over the floor. And he comes running into the room. Jack comes running in and says, "What's it? What? All I did is ask him since he had no use for the desk lamp, what's the matter?" I says, "Sit down, you slob. Sit down. Just stay there and shut up and eat the fig Newtons. Here, you can have all the fig Newtons. Eat them." And so Jack went back to mulching. You know, there's a certain thing with the ruminant, as you find with the guinea pig. When the guinea pig gets excited, give him a piece of lettuce. That's the end of the ball game. He'll not get excited anymore. It is a well-known fact, even among racehorses. When a racehorse gets on his uppers, you know, you just hand him an apple and you got him in the palm of your hand. Well, with the type that Jack was, shove him a box of cookies, shove him a box of Fig Newtons, and he's calm. So I shoved the Fig Newtons in his trap, and he's sitting there munching away in a Fig Newtons. And I hear the shower clogs go dragging by again towards the shower. Now, I don't know why I'm telling you this saga of life. He went dragging by, and I got up and I walked out into the hall, and I could see Howard turn into the shower room. And he walks in towards the showers. I hear the water turning on. I walked down by myself, and I walked in. I said, "Did it happen, Howard?" He said, "What do you think?" I said, "What are you laughing about?" "It." I said, "It? What do you mean, it?" He says, "All of it. The periodic table, organic chemistry, log-log desitrig slide rules. All of it. Jack Miner, the whole damn bit." He starts to laugh. Have you ever seen a guy with a true sense of irony laugh at life? There he is in the shower room of our dormitory, a bastion of intellectuality and seething passions, a bastion of sex and thwarted desires. And Howard is standing next to the sink, Jaybird naked, with a towel in his hand and his dop kit in the other hand, laughing at life.
Oh my God, what a joke.
Well, I figured I better get out. He is laughing like hell. At which point, I run back down through the hallway, and I make the left turn into the room, and there is dumb, fat Jack Miner sitting there, who is now wandering his way through the wonderful, exciting world of butterscotch iced Fig Newtons. He's halfway through the last two or three Fig Newtons, mulching away. Yet, like a true ruminant, he chewed from side to side. Yeah, you got to understand that there are among us those who have not achieved full human status. This is in I know I'm flying into the faith of many a liberal's beliefs, but there are among us many who have not come as high up the evolutionary ladder as others more fortunate. And it is an unfortunate thing. Jack, somewhere way back in his family, a bull must have got into somebody's farmhouse. And the taint had remained forever. Jack chewed from side to side. That was irritating. I'll tell you, he had so many damned irritating habits. Have you ever lived with a roommate that after about... And it was just the luck of the draw. I got this slob. I did not ask for this guy. He was not a friend of mine. He didn't come from the same hometown, nothing. Just, he was... When I was a freshman, I was assigned to this room, and there he was. He was assigned to that room, where we were. Now, he smoked that damn purple haze tobacco, and I used to sit and watch him chew. He would sit on the end of my bunk, always, and he would chew from side to side. He had a chewing from side to side motion, and he would chew with an absolute concentration and with a blank look in the eye. He always reminded me of a prominent member of the bovine. You know, he was literally a cud chewer. So he's chewing away there, see, and I said, "Here, finish the Fig Newtons, Jack." I was feeling a little nervous about what was going on down in the shower room, and off in the distance you could hear Howard still continuing his great roars of laughter. And it comes echoing back, and it finally soaked through this clod Jack Miner's head that something was going on out there. He says, What's happening down in the shower, huh?" I said, "None of your damn business, Jack." I knew he could not understand such a delicate human emotion as irony. No way. Jack was the kind of guy who was so low in the passion scale, so low in the nerve-ending and ganglia scale, that, like the turtle, he did not feel much pain. you could kick him heavily in the rear end, and it would take 15 or 20 minutes for him to understand that he's been kicked due to the fact he had a very, very primitive nervous system. Like many of the lower orders, he did not feel pain such as we human beings understand it, so he would not have understood something like irony. So he said, "What's going on?" I said, "Nothing, Howard." He said, "It's nothing, Jack." He says, "Somebody must be telling jokes down there." So he gets up and he walks down, because he loved to hear dirty jokes, what he called a dirty joke. So he walks down through the... by the way, ever since my two-year forced acquaintance with Jack Miner, I have had an absolute hatred of dirty jokes. I mean, I can't stand them. I can't stand them. Because the only thing Jack ever said outside of, "Hey, you got anything to eat here?" He'd say that once in a while. Occasionally he would say, "Got any beer?" That was another thing he would say. He would also say this. He'd sit down, totally humorless, like many of the lower primates. He was completely without humor. So he would come in and he'd say, "Hey, did you hear the one about this guy that was a salesman, you know?" And he's trembling around, and at that moment, it was something in the look of his eye, the dirty joke look in the eye. I couldn't stand even to listen to him. And he would always boot it. At the end, he would always miss you. And then the girl said, "You got your necktie on." No, that's not right. "Hey, Clarence, how did that joke?" Oh, I want to kill it. So that's why I hated him. Well, I know what I was suffering from, because I have been antisocial ever since. Have you noticed that then I get nervous? I hate cocktail parties, all this stuff. I developed a severe case towards the end of the fourth semester. Absolutely virulent case of cabin fever. I began to hate the room because I could smell Jack Miner in it. That was another thing. I won't even bother you with that. Like the lower ruminants again, he had a very, very basic digestive system. Extremely basic. He was an eating machine. He was a converter of food into various chemicals. So I would come in and it would just hit me. I'd smell that Turkish tobacco. It smelled like Saturday night in Izmir, in the House of Ill Fame. I'll tell you another thing he was. He was the most accomplished burper I have ever known. And he used to have long, drawn-out burps with all kinds of arpeggios. And he used to love it. It was his only talent. And his answer to any kind of subtlety of conversation, for example... one of my friends would come in. I had a lot of friends, you know, who wrote for the yearbook and that kind of stuff. One would come running in and say, "Hey, did you read that essay by George Orwell? The one that was about, did you read the one about hunting elephants in India when he was a member of the police?" And this, of course, bugged Jack. Jack did not understand any of these things. And he, like many true slobs, believed that anything he did not understand was an effete affectation. In addition to that, they were all faking it. And so my friends would come in, a guy would say, hey, did you read that thing by Orwell? Jack would go, and then he always had that third or fourth note that he would squeeze out of it. Oh. Well, that added more to the pungency of the room. So on this historic day, Jack finally got what was coming to him. Because everybody on the floor hated not only Jack Miner, we hated the guy we called... Well, you heard what I said about that guy. The guy with the four-letter word name, yes, that comes from two hands being struck smartly in applause. He was called that. It began with a C, because it was known that every communicable disease possible, everything from cold sores to rot at the barrow of the marrow of the bone came from this guy. So the two of them were our twin sisters of hate. But Jack was hated for other reasons. And this day, when Jack got it, it ranks with my pantheon of great moments of true justice. Not many times in your life you see justice meted out where it's deserved. And we will tell you this great moment in just a moment after we lay a little goody on you. Or maybe two goodies. Or maybe three.
Hey.
Okay. I'm not going to tell you. Bring it up. You blew it. Lay a promo on me and you're going to get that for your... You're going to get that for your pains every time. Bring it up there. Oh, I mean, I'll tell you. See what I mean? You can push up, but just so far enough. Ah, sweet mystery of life. This is WOR New York. You stay tuned for Lester Smith and the news.